Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss Geiger and Muller counter. This Geiger and Muller counter is a gas filled ionization counter. What do we mean by gas filled ionization counter is it works with the inert gases like argon, neon, xenon, and it works on the ionization principle and it is a counting device. Geiger and Muller developed a detector for measuring ionization radiation in 1928. They named this device as Geiger Muller counter. It is most widely used nuclear detector used to detect the presence of radioactivity. In this device, amplification is independent of initial energy carried by the ionizing particle, and it is used for detecting and counting ionization radiation like alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. So at the beginning, let us recall few basics. So what do we mean by ionization? Sufficiently energetic charged particles like alpha, beta from the radioactive materials or radiant energy like gamma rays travel through the medium, and when they come in close with the atom or a molecule, this atom or molecule loses electron and acquire positive charge. This process of splitting of inert gas atom into positively charged ion and a free electron is called as ionization. What is avalanche? Avalanche is a huge amount of ice, snow, and or rocks sliding or falling rapidly down an inclined slope such as a mountain side is called as avalanche. What is Townsend avalanche? The Townsend avalanche is a gas ionization process where free electrons are accelerated by an electric field, collide with the gas molecules and consequently free additional electrons. Those electrons are in turn accelerated and free few more additional electrons. The result is an avalanche multiplication that permits electrical conduction through the gas. So let us see the construction of GM tube. So this cylindrical shape, I am trying to put it as the metal cylinder. This metal cylinder tube is treated as a cathode, and at the center of this cathode there is a tungsten wire. This tungsten wire is a anode. This anode and cathode are insulated from each other by the ebonite plugs shown at the ends of the tungsten wire. So this tube which was evacuated is now filled with the inert gas. So these blue circles are denoting the ionization gas. And there is another gas present in small amount, that is quenching gas. This ionizing gas and quenching gas, the proportion is maintained at 10:1. This anode, we can see it is connected to positive terminal of the battery through the resistance, and cathode is connected to negative terminal of the battery. This assembly is now connected to a counting device. This counting device will count the generated pulse from the generated current from the GM tube. So we can see at the other end of this GM tube we have a window. Through this window the ionizing radiation will enter into the tube. It will generate a current through the Townsend avalanche, and the current will flow through this device and will get counted by the electronic counting device. These are the labels of the symbols present in the diagram. So let us see how does this process is occurring. So let us say that this is the ionizing, the inert gas molecule. The ionizing radiation is coming in contact with the inert gas molecule. The inert gas atom or molecule is splitted into positively charged ion and electron. This electron being negatively charged is getting accelerated towards the central anode, and the positively charged ion is moving towards the cathode. So we will split the working into two parts, counting the incoming radiation and getting ready for the next count. So counting the incoming radiation, how does it occur? is, let us say that this line is representing the path of the incoming radiation. This incoming radiation, like alpha particle or beta particle or gamma rays, they have enough energy to ionize many atoms in the GM tube. So let us assume a single event that is occurring here. This is a original ionization event where the incoming particle has caused the ionization and a positively charged ion is moving towards the cathode and in this direction, and the negatively charged electron, it is moving in the downward direction. So this original ionization event, what it has done is it will cause the electrons to emit a photon of energy, and this photon of energy will be absorbed by some other electron here, we can see, and this will excite the other electron. Or otherwise, this electron, what it can do is it will get accelerated towards the central anode, and while doing this it will gain energy, and this energy it will use to excite another electron. So the energy that is electron is gaining by getting accelerated towards moving towards the cathode anode, the electron is gaining energy by accelerating towards the anode. It may be used into two ways. One is, electron is approaching the anode, gaining the energy. This excited electron decays in the photon and excites some other electron. Or otherwise, this electron approaching anode gains energy, frees some other electron, and this free electron accelerates. So you can see the avalanche is taking place all along the length of the central wire anode, and there are two ways by which it is happening. One is decaying into the photons and exciting new electrons, or gaining the energy and excites new free electrons, secondary electrons. So that is the case with the electron, that it is gaining energy and moving towards the anode and causing an avalanche or a current through the circuit. But what is happening to the anode, that is what is happening to the positively charged ion which is moving towards the cathode? So this positively charged ion, when it is moving towards the cathode, it may cause emission of secondary electrons from the cathode itself. So this secondary electrons emission will cause a spurious count or a dummy count or a false count, which is undesirable. So this positively charged ion, it should not emit secondary electrons from the, it should not knock out the secondary electrons from the cathode. So to stop this, what do we do is called as quenching. So there are two ways of quenching. One is called as external quenching and the other is called as internal quenching. So what do we do in external quenching? We take help from the voltage applied externally. One is, operating voltage is reduced for a short period of time, or the polarity of the counter electrodes is reversed after the pulse is detected. So this stops secondary electrons or photons liberation and no spurious count will be detected. Otherwise, in internal quenching, what do we do is a quenching gas like bromine or some other gas is used. The gas is such that its ionization energy is less than the main detecting gas. So what this gas will do is it will absorb the charge and the energy carried by the positively charged ion while moving towards the cathode, and it will dissociate and eventually it will recombine. Otherwise, in few cases, alcohol vapor is also used, where this alcohol vapor gets dissociated by absorbing charge and energy, but this alcohol vapor will get depleted on the cathode, that will limit the life of the GM tube. So there are two important concepts into the working of the GM tube. One is dead time and other is recovery time. So in dead time, the GM tube remains temporarily unable to detect the arrival of any new ionizing particle. This time is called as dead time. If a new ionizing particle enters into the tube, a new avalanche will not be initiated because the avalanche is produced enough ionization in the tube, and thus a new particle will not be detected by the device. Thus, for a short time after the discharge pulse, there is a period during which the tube remains insensitive. This time is called as dead time. This dead time is of the order of few hundred microseconds in the GM tube. This recovery time is after the phase of dead time, GM tube once again start registering the incident radiation. However, the pulse height might not be completely to its fullest height as required by the counter, and it takes a little bit longer time for the pulses to grow to its original height. This time duration for which the pulses are not countable height and after some time it again regain the original pulse height is called as recovery time. So in these graphs we will see how this dead time and recovery time are present into the working of the GM tube. So here you see this is the original ionization event that has taken place, and during this time the next ionization event cannot be counted. So after this dead time is over and this tube is ready for the next count, in this time the secondary small pulses will be generated not of the required height. So this time will be called as recovery time. So how does this tube works? The electrons generated in the process are absorbed by the anode, and these electrons will flow through the circuit and there will be a voltage drop across the resistance and it will be registered. So this voltage drop will be present and it will start recovering, and new voltage pulses will be start generating. Current will be generated, and when this level is reached, then new pulse can be detected. So there is, when we keep increasing the voltage and count the counts per minute, then the graph will be like as shown in this figure. So for the initial few voltage values, there won't be any count. When the count starts coming, this voltage will be called as threshold voltage, and the count will keep increasing in this region. With this region is called as proportional region, and after the some value is reached, which is a new voltage value, in this region, which is called as plateau region, the count recorded by the device is independent of the voltage of the operating voltage of the tube, and at the center of this it will be called as operating voltage. After this region, it is called as continuous discharge region, where the count is independent of the incoming radiation and a continuous discharge takes place. So a GM tube must be operated at the operating voltage which is at the center of the plateau region, and it should not be operated in the proportional region where the count is increasing with the increase in voltage, or the count is registered without the incoming radiation, that is the continuous discharge region. So the advantages of the GM tube is operation is simple, it provides a strong signal, no need of pre-amplifier to amplify the signal, it can be used for any kind of radiation, and it can be also used for neutrons with some modification, and it is relatively inexpensive. The disadvantages are it cannot differentiate between the radiations, and it has a very high dead time, and there are few applications of this GM tube.